Good evening, folks. I'm Billy Keels, the headmaster here at Lovett, and it's a privilege to welcome you to this evening's lecture. Robert Krick is our fourth speaker in the Civil War and the Forging of Character series. This series is made possible by the Ann and Jack Lynn Character Education Fund here at Lovett, and by brothers Austin, Bob, Jack, and Lewis Glenn. Bob and Austin are both here tonight. We thank you, gentlemen, for making this possible. Let me also thank several of my colleagues, Kimbrough Haverstock, Megan Morris, Sandy Bedella, and Kim Blass, who attended to so many of the details connected with this lecture series. Thanks are also due to our speakers committee, which includes Chief Advancement Officer Andy Spencer, Communications Director Kim Blass, Trustees Hampton Morris and Bob Glenn, Lovett parent and alum Amanda Glenn Brady, and the Atlanta History Center's senior military historian Dr. Gordon Jones. We're so blessed to have a wonderful partnership with the Atlanta History Center, and especially with Gordon and his CEO there at the History Center, Sheffield Hale, and their great teammates. Sheffield is here tonight. We thank him and so appreciate and respect the work he's doing. Sheffield, welcome. Thanks for helping me there. Folks, this series will continue through April 2015, and a reminder that our next lecture in this series will take place here at Lovett on March 24th when Dr. Joan Waugh of UCLA will speak on Ulysses S. Grant and how Grant is regarded and remembered across time. Dr. Waugh teaches one of the most popular courses at UCLA, and you'll want to hear her when she's here. It's now a pleasure to introduce Robert K. Krick, this evening's speaker. Bob grew up in Northern California, but he's lived and worked on East Coast Civil War battlefields for more than four decades. For 30 years, he was chief historian at the Fredericksburg and Spotsylvania National Military Park. He's the author of 20 books and more than 200 published articles. He is staying with Penny and me up at the Lardens house, and this afternoon he was working on yet another article. His Stonewall Jackson at Cedar Mountain, published in 1990, which I'm having the privilege of reading, won three national awards, including the Douglas Southold Freeman Prize for Best Book in Southern History. Bob retired in January 2002 as chief historian at the Fredericksburg and Spotsylvania National Military Park, and then devoted 3 years to writing the words on the walls of the National Museum of the Marine Corps in Quantico, which is a stunning place. When Bob Krick started working for the National Park Service in 1967, the Fredericksburg and Spotsylvania Military Park had less than 3,000 acres. He tells me it was 2,800 exactly, and when he retired, that number had grown to 8,000. And it was Bob who was responsible for most of the success around increasing the size of that park. As chief historian there, he was constantly pushing for legislation and federal funding that would allow the park to expand. In effect, he's committed almost 40 years to preserving battlefields connected with the most significant conflict in our history, the Civil War. Upon receiving news of his retirement, senators and congressmen in Washington on both sides of the aisle, and I think Bob's got a little bit of a chuckle of that, about that, on both sides of the aisle, praised him widely for his truly extraordinary commitment to the preservation and enhancement of historic Civil War battlefields. Senator Jeffords of Vermont called him a true stalwart in saving battlefields. Senator Torricelli of New Jersey and Krick said Krick's preservation efforts will provide Americans with an invaluable resource to study and learn from for generations to come. New York Congressman Robert Marzak, to whom Krick is very close, described Bob as the greatest secret weapon for Civil War battlefield preservation we've ever had. Historian and author Howard Coffin said that Krick's record in preservation is a legacy that will challenge the Park Service in future years. Gary Gallagher, noted University of Virginia Civil War historian, in one of our earlier lectures in this series, he spoke here about a year ago, as a matter of fact, says that Krick turned the Fredericksburg battlefield into an absolute model for other parks. Gallagher also says that Krick knows more about the Army of Northern Virginia than anyone else who's written about it, including the legendary historian Douglas Southold Freeman. Gallagher goes on to say that Krick is painstaking in his research, determined to get to the truth, and incredibly generous when it comes to sharing his own research with others. And I've seen that in my getting to know Bob these last several hours. As Bob Krick knows, Gallagher also describes Kit Krick as a bit of a curmudgeon, someone who'll bluntly tell the truth as he sees it. We saw evidence of that this morning when he gave a wonderful lecture on Stonewall Jackson. That quality of telling the truth as he sees it was really in full force this morning when he spoke to our American Studies students and to a number of other guests about the nuances and the complexities and the paradoxes of Stonewall Jackson's character. We look forward to hearing what Bob has to say about Robert E. Lee tonight. Please join me in welcoming Robert Krick to the Lovett School.
Thirty years after the Civil War had ended, time had worked on the memories of the Confederates who fought it in their youth. It had smoothed away some of the rancor, much of the hardship, and the suffering, and brightened the recollections of the 1860s. It seemed a bit more dramatic than it had at the time and a little less onerous. Furthermore, by then, the late Victorian zeitgeist, the spirit of the times in that late Victorian era, had become attuned to romantic imagery and flowery language. As a result, much of the turn-of-the-century writing by ex-Confederates, by both sides, dipped into purple prose and hyperbole. Characteristic of this is a fellow much associated with Atlanta and your state house and so on, John B. Gordon from Georgia. His memoirs are the purplest of prose. A counterpart on the northern side would be Joshua Lawrence Chamberlain, who's gotten to be famous in recent years. In Gordon's pages, although almost 650,000 Americans died in uniform, many of them in horrible circumstances, in Gordon's pages, no one ever dies in mortal anguish. Instead, a speeding leaden messenger frees his warrior soul to go to Valhalla with his fellow heroes. By then, this being the turn of the century, the era of rapprochement, those heroes in Valhalla were from both sides. That's the way things were by then. Joshua Chamberlain, the Federal, his egocentric narratives unfold with very little space for anyone but his own self. But when it does, the scene plays out as a sort of chivalric medieval joust of one kind or another. Well, the taste for that kind of prose faded a long time ago, leaving behind skepticism not only about the medium, but about the message. In fact, almost everything that Gordon said can be substantiated, although a lot of it was held in doubt for a while. But that tells you something about the memory in which Confederates look back after 30 years. Having spent a lengthy professional life, as I have, attempting to filter a semblance of truth from the fiction, I admit to being a skeptic about many things said by Confederates and Federals, especially the vintage 1890 to 1920. And I'm going to spend a few minutes giving you some examples of that before I go on to be positive about much of the other stuff. A list of the old soldiers who claimed to have been personally promoted by General Lee during the retreat to Appomattox and the paperwork was lost would fill a volume. Similarly, obituaries of Confederates which lime the dead man as a steadfast hero to the end don't match up with the service record, which will show him AWOL in 64 and getting paroled before the end of the year. There's a lot of that. Rank mushroomed post-war at a very considerable level, almost a transmogrification of everyone to high rank. Writing early in the 20th century, a pundit, my favorite writer of American English of all time, suggested it was wise to refer to any adult male south of Wilmington, Delaware as Colonel, unless you knew for sure that he preferred Judge. And some of you, you're responding, some of you are familiar with that syndrome. A mayoral candidate in Richmond, Virginia, which many of you are familiar with, had been a private in Parker's Virginia Battery, about which I wrote a book long ago when I was young. He was running for mayor, and he'd been a private, and he boasted of it. I was a private. And he said, from what I can see, looking around and in the newspapers, I apparently was the only private soldier in the Army of Northern Virginia. So this kind of reverse snobbery worked, and Davy Crockett Richardson got elected the mayor of Richmond. And bragging on a war record, not always accurately and never modestly, in quest of political advancement, came to be known in the North as waving the bloody shirt. You see the symbolism there. It was every bit as prevalent in the South, although they didn't use that particular rubric for it. Colonel Frederick W.M. Holliday could never have become governor of Virginia, the pundits said, had he not lost an arm at Cedar Mountain. And most famously in this vein, General Francis R.T. Nichols of Louisiana, who had lost an arm at Winchester and a foot at Chancellorsville, the fellow fervently putting him in nomination for governor of Louisiana, said, "I nominate all that is left of General Nichols to be governor of Louisiana." And during the campaign, they picked up on that refrain, and the occasionally similarly mangled veteran would say, "What's left of me is going to vote for what's left of General Nichols." Well, Holliday and Nichols had plenty of service on which to boast. Many another claimant did not. A few years ago, a very careful researcher, an acquaintance of mine, very careful fellow, examined the last half dozen surviving Confederate veterans, self-proclaimed. Now, I'm younger than some of you and older than some of you, but I remember, I would have been 15 when it happened, when the last Confederate veteran, so-called, died, and they had a state funeral for him, and the president went and so on in Texas. He had ostensibly been a member of Hood's Texas Brigade. Well, the fellow checking into the last surviving Confederates found that Willie Williams, the Texas fellow, and all of the other six were bogus. They just absolutely were bogus. In Williams's case, I think he was in the 1870 census in the right place with the right parents at the age of 5. But the attention, the applause, during the Depression, the pension was just irresistible. So that result really wasn't surprising to me, but it nicely highlights the whole problem of late life fantasy, if not outright mendacity. Significantly, very significantly to my point tonight, that investigation also established identical results for the last half dozen elderly pseudo-Union veterans. Soldiers grown old sometimes ramble away from reliability. Often very far indeed do they ramble, whatever their longitude. Veterans of World War II and Korea, who gather today, and I subscribe to a great many of their quarterly reunion journals, and I read them with genuine appreciation, they look back over the decades with sometimes similar results, not the outright fakery, but with a little bit more glowing. If I were talking to you in John Gordon's era, I couldn't give you a personal story that was considered bad taste. But I had a personal experience that I think kind of highlighted this for me a few years ago. My wife's dad was mortally stricken and he was dying, and the family gathered round and everyone did what they could. He had a granddaughter who was a CPA, which was useful in those dolorous circumstances. I was a historian. What good is a historian? And that's rhetorical. Don't any of you try to answer that. Well, what I did was I went up and I found that my father-in-law had the proverbial shoebox. Everybody has a shoebox. It was literally in the attic, with all of his mementos from a trek across Europe in the 1940s with the United States Army. It included a fairly meticulously kept map and sundry and various things left over from helping to win World War II. And I went back channel, it's usually very hard to find, they being sequestered for living veterans, to get his service record quickly from my friends at the National Archives, and I found everything that he had was pretty much accurate. But then trying to extend it farther, I had his unit. Trying to extend it farther, I looked into the unit. The unit, some of you will have heard of, not by its name, but because of a radio story, the 603rd Camouflage Engineer Battalion. Now, Paul Harvey a couple of times featured that in his histrionic The Rest of the Story. You know how he built it up and then tried to pay it off at the end. This camouflage battalion was engaged in counterintelligence and fakery. They had huge rubber tanks and trucks and half-tracks, which they could blow up with an air generator. And what few German airplanes were still aloft would see them and think there were more than there. They toted all around Europe with them a mobile paint operation. And when they went into a new town, they'd set up in a big gymnasium or something, and they would drive significant numbers of the Corps, the Army's vehicles up and down streets where it was thought that friends of the Germans might be looking out the window. And then overnight they would repaint the bumpers with a different Army, a different Corps, a different division. All of this as misinformation. Well, they did it's not a bad idea. They probably did some good. I tried to find a unit history. There wasn't one. One member of this group of artists, arty people, went on to become a famous fashion designer, Bill Blass. He was in the unit. Some of you will have purses that he produced or whatever he produces. And he had written a memoir. So I went and looked at that, and he had a little bit about the war, but it was mostly about his post-war kind of romantic gymnastics in Hollywood, to put it politely. So I didn't buy that from my father-in-law. But what I found then, and here's what I'm talking about. This long after World War II, very much like Confederates writing in about 1915, they had a website. It was well done, it was attractive. It had a list of surviving members who belonged. I printed that out and showed to my father-in-law. But then it went on to boast about what they had accomplished. He said, historians now acknowledge that our efforts in the battalion can be credited for shortening the war by several years and saving as many as 100,000 lives. Now, U.S. involvement in World War II, as you remember, was less than 4 years, and several, by definition, is at least three. The war might still be going on in Europe if it weren't for those rubber tanks and all. Well, I reported this to my wife's dad, and his wife was sitting there with him, and she said, "Oh, Elwood, that's impressive." And he said, "Oh, no, that's deleted." And he had the good sense to see what that was. This is entirely typical. There's nothing malicious about it. There's nothing Machiavellian. It's not calculated. These are old men, like many of us, who were soldiers once when they were young. None of this universality that I'm talking about, everybody does it. None of that makes errant nonsense when it appears in Confederate memoirs any less annoying, any more palatable, not at all excusable. That's not the point at all. But tendentious modern historians insist that the rosy glow infusing the lost cause, which is the word for anything any Southerner wrote about the war, that this is somehow unique. They go further to identify it as the conscious manipulative creations of a defeated people. And R.E. Lee, my special topic tonight, according to this insane strain, was not really all that popular during the war. I'm going to read you some quotes about that from leading debunkers. He really wasn't all that popular. He only became an icon when carefully created as one after the war, having been chosen by these Machiavellian folks who were trying to reshape history, conspirators who faced the need for a Southern hero. Thomas Connelly's inaugural book, the first one in that vein, many of you will have heard of, says, almost unbelievably it seems to me, not until the 1880s would Lee be regarded as the South's invincible general. At his death, this eminence lay years ahead. Here's a second one from someone else about a decade later. When he died on October 12, 1870, Lee was only one of a large number of Confederate heroes and clearly behind some of them. 10 more years, and another historian wrote in a widely circulated book, Virginians directed post-war efforts to recast Robert E. Lee as the Confederacy's great hero. One can only ache in the heart for Braxton Bragg and Van Dorn and H.H. Sibley and the other guys who were euchred out of the chance to be on bronze horses on Monument Avenue. If you believe this, you'll believe anything. It's just utter nonsense. The absolutely immense body of adulation for Lee during the war would seem to be impossible to ignore. In wondering how anyone could miss that tsunami of contemporary evidence, I'm driven to a philosophical construction. Hanlon's razor. I don't know if any of you have heard of that. Everybody's heard of Occam's razor. He was, a 14th century cleric who posited the Occam's razor rule is that the simplest answer usually is the right one. That wouldn't work today, especially in Washington, from what I can tell, but that's what Friar Occam said. Well, this is a 20th century when in Hanlon's razor, he suggests, and this might apply to a lot of things that you experience in life, never attribute to malice what can be adequately explained by ignorance or sloth. This is sort of the anti-conspiratorial mandate. Don't immediately assume malice. It may be, in essence, stupidity and laziness, or ignorance and sloth, as he puts it. Pretending that countless tens of thousands of Confederates who hymned Lee's stature during the war, pretending they don't exist seems just about unimaginable. Is it driven by malice? Well, some of it surely is. Or is it ignorance and sloth? Perhaps. In a case so flagrant as this, there's ample room for those motives and more abundantly distributed. It really is startling. There is the virtually unrelated question, I hasten to say, and you will have thought of this by now probably, of whether Lee deserved the adulation. Was he a great general? Was he a great man? Was he a great personality? Was he a great character? Was he any of those things? That's an entirely different matter. The question here, vis-a-vis the modern revisionist anti-Lee slant, is whether he was created as such post-war. They may have been wrong, those contemporary Confederates, although I surely do not believe so, but that's a separate question from what their attitude was. All of us, as we evaluate information, as we try to decide which stock to buy, which spouse to marry, all of the big and small decisions in life, we evaluate things based on kind of a criteria of importance and reliability and so on. And anyone who looks at historical things has got to do that too. There are Confederate accounts, I'll give you a couple samples, that are charming and colorful and wonderfully readable, and those of you who are in the know here, and I see several of you, will have read them, but they're not really all that reliable. Robert Stiles, I like him. In fact, I edited a reprint of his book 30 years ago or thereabouts. He's a Virginia artillerist, and he wrote about interesting things and interesting people, and he wrote well, but he's kind of on the hyperbole rocket from time to time. One of his contemporaries at the University of Virginia wrote that Stiles' enthusiasms reminded him of a boy who, after flushing a flock of sparrows, writes of a great flight of bald eagles he had seen. And that may be a little too much, but Stiles is more fun than he is reliable, and I wouldn't quote him in a serious case. Henry Kidd Douglas is another wonderful example, and many of you will have read him. His book, published first by the University of North Carolina Press in 1940, a tremendous bestseller, and it deserves to be because it's a great read and it's full of interesting stuff. I Rode with Stonewall. He was sometime on Jackson's staff, not a long time. I Rode with Stonewall. The thing is incredibly egocentric, though. More than one person has suggested, and I'm not the first, that the title should have been Stonewall Rode with Me. And there are a number of other japes of that sort aimed at Douglas. I won't take time to tell you. Headmaster Peebles mentioned Congressman Bob Mrazek in the introduction. Because of Bob Mrazek, who's the most important man in saving battlefields in my lifetime, bless his heart, I'm really glad for Kid Douglas, because he loved Kid Douglas. And the first time I went into his office, I just looked it up for a fellow who's writing a history of the preservation movement. It was in October of 1988. I waited outside while he saw a succession of people on the list who were kind of frightening to me. They were Hamp Morris kind of crazy people. And I went in and I was much relieved the moment I walked in the door. There was a larger than life-size blow-up of Henry Kidd Douglas, of all people on earth, on Bob Mrazek's wall. He just loved Kidd Douglas and loved everything about the Civil War and did a great deal for us. So hats off to Stonewall Road with me. Then there's William Nelson Pendleton. You know his name perhaps. He was an august fellow. He looked like General Lee. He was often confused on the street for General Lee. He was an Episcopal rector, which is a pretty important thing, I gather, Billy, from what you've told me. He was, in fact, R.E. Lee's pastor in Lexington, Virginia after the war. His Civil War narratives, however, I would think when he strapped on the surplice, he signed up for a degree of honesty and so on, but late in life, his narratives about the Civil War almost always strayed onto a tangent, leading away from the truth, sometimes on a direct reciprocal, as direct as it could go. And he actually is, when I was young and innocent, which is getting to be a long time ago, Pendleton interested me in this wise. People were talking about the Gettysburg controversy, which roared in the 1870s, and this is part of this, Confederates made it up. And they all jumped on Longstreet. Pendleton, from his august, bully a pulpit as you can imagine, given his pedigree, he said, "I was there when I heard General Lee tell General Longstreet to attack at dawn," which is utter nonsense. That didn't happen. And it struck me almost immediately when I saw that, and the talk was about the Confederate veterans ganging up on people and making things up. Here was a real opportunity to get Longstreet, who deserved to be gotten, don't misunderstand me. But here was Pendleton saying he heard the attack order. None of Lee's other staff, they were all still alive, Venable and Marshall and Taylor and Talcott and all of those fellows were still alive. None of them took that opportunity to get on that convenient bandwagon. They all said, "That's not so, we know it's not so." So it's a question of picking out who is best. In contravention of the Pendleton and the rest syndrome I've described, there are some people who are just about oracular Edward Porter Alexander, whose memoirs have been published, the best memoir out of the Army in Northern Virginia. Gary Gallagher, who was here before, edited that thing and has bought three or four Buicks in a row on the royalties from it. I kind of wish I'd done it myself. It's just a wonderful book, and Pendleton is just about unimpeachable. William Allen was chief of ordnance and then became Lee's private secretary after the war and scribbled everything he could see. Highly reliable. Jedediah Hotchkiss of Jackson's staff. Many of you will have heard of Jed Hotchkiss. Highly reliable. But to attribute near invincible reliability to those fellows makes no more sense than accepting that from the rest of them. You've got to look at it with just at least a little bit of balance. Tarring all primary Confederate sources as dishonest, disingenuous post-war makes no sense. Accepting all of them doesn't either. Few people have trouble attempting to sort out the good from the bad. Unfortunately, quite a few revisionist historians don't even begin to make an effort, I'm sorry to say. A corollary of the don't believe anything a Southerner wrote affectation is the scornful rejection of anything that's post-war. And it makes sense. The earlier, the better. There's no question about that. I've just talked to you at length about how later in life things turn rosy for everybody in every era from every war. But the absence of evidence is not the same thing. I stood for many years with the aforesaid Gary Gallagher, who likes to pick on me for some reason. I guess I'm an easy target. And he pointed out my notion that the Confederates had to go up East Cemetery Hill and culp sail. If Jackson had been there, he would have done it. Everybody in the Army knew that they were missing Jackson. Scores of them said so, but the only ones available 20, 25 years ago were post-war. And so this was the conventional wisdom, which Gary embraced just to annoy me, I'm pretty sure, was that this is all more the lost cause. These fellows just made this up. Nobody said it at the time. Well, in the years since, any number of things have turned up. I've found five or six of them myself. R.E. Lee himself, on the 19th day of February in 1870, said, and William Allen wrote it down that morning when he got back to his office, talking about July 1863, Allen's pencil note says, "General Lee often thinks that if Jackson had been there, he would have succeeded." Now, that admittedly is 6.5 years after Gettysburg. But listen to just this one example that comes from a North Carolina lieutenant writing home to his family 4 days after the Battle of Gettysburg, talking about that delay the night of the first day of July, foot of East Cemetery Hill. "That delay was fatal to us. We lost the golden opportunity. It is hardly possible to say how great our victory would have been. There we missed the genius of Jackson. The simplest soldier in the ranks felt it." Well, there remains the opportunity for you to think that he's wrong about this, that going up the slopes of East Cemetery Hill and Culp's Hill would not have made the big difference. But there's no longer any opportunity to claim that this is a post-war invention by people looking for an excuse. That I just read you, I could not have sat down with a pen and a sheet of paper and done better myself, making it up out of whole cloth to support the point of how people felt. What about Lee's battlefield attainments as opposed to what people thought about him? It seems clear to me that Lee, against very long odds, crafted some of the most amazing campaigns in American history. In a course of 8 weeks, starting in the June of 1862, he moved the war from the outskirts of Richmond within sight of the spires of the Capitol to the doorstep of Washington within 8 weeks. It's hard to contemplate anyone else doing that. With an army that was not yet sculpted at all to his preferences, commanded by subalterns, by subordinate leaders, the majority of whom he would wash out of the army very soon thereafter, as soon as he got a chance, he stood the war right straight on its head. It's impossible to imagine Joe Johnston, who he supplanted after a fortuitous spray of an exploding artillery shell, badly wounded Johnston. It's hard to imagine Johnston doing this. It's hard to imagine Johnston moving a half a mile forward ever, anywhere, under any circumstances. Lee stood the war on its ear. The Second Manassas Campaign, part of that revolution in that summer of 62, was the launching of the fabulous collaboration between Lee and Jackson, the quintessential executive officer. Their interrelationship was unlike any other during the war. Chancellorsville, the greatest of Lee's triumphs and Jackson's last, of course. and against the greatest odds by far of the whole war. Lee never faced odds like that again until a few hours before Appomattox. I think Chancellorsville is simply incomparable. The salient criticism of Lee there, which I engaged in myself in writing 25 years or so, has succumbed to correspondence with Jeb Stuart that survived out at the Huntington Library in California. The whole story of how some of Virginia's best Confederate resources wound up in California is an elaborate and interesting one, and I have some wonderful stories about that, but no time to tell them. But out there turned up his correspondence with Stuart, whom he had left behind at Chancellorsville in command of the troops there. And his instructions to Stuart in great detail on the morning of both the 4th and the 5th of May are exactly what they should have been. When he got back there on the 6th himself, he didn't explain to everyone what he was doing, but his orders to Stuart make it clear he was not about to go high diddle diddle up the middle into those trenches. He knew that Hooker was going to retreat across the river, and it's an absolute axiom in military affairs when your enemy is retreating, especially across a geographical obstacle, you must hurt him. That has nothing to do with taking the offensive. So I have got to recant. I've got to repent of what I wrote 25 years ago. Lee's impact upon the soldiery was a priceless national asset. There was nothing more important than it, and that, of course, is the antithesis of this hokum that I'm complaining to you about tonight. On the same 4th of May in 63 that Lee corresponded with Stuart, which I just talked about, things had fallen apart, had gone awry with the detachments he'd sent east toward Salem Church in the Chancellorsville rear guard, variously called Second Battle of Fredericksburg, Battle of Salem Church. Lafayette McClaws from Georgia, who was a solid fellow but not full of metabolism, and Jubal Early and Dick Anderson, who was as phlegmatic as he could be, were back there, and they weren't getting things under control, and Lee lost his temper for one of the two recorded times during the war when he got back there and saw it. The troops knew that things were awry. They recognized the disarray, and they were stirring restlessly. Here's Major Richard Watson York writing at the time. York's father was the founder of Duke University, essentially, and York himself was a college professor there and wrote a number of textbooks and was a very serious fellow. I don't suppose he was given to vapors, as they used to say. And he wrote at the time about what was going on. He said, "I never saw officers and men so utterly and so generally demoralized. I myself, to some extent, participated in the demoralization." But then Lee had come back. They didn't know it until he got there. "Suddenly we saw passing through the thin woods behind us General Lee. As soon as his face was well seen, the word went down the line, 'All is right. Uncle Robert is here. We will whip them.' There was no cheering. The men leaned on their muskets and looked at him as though a god were passing by." Now that's pretty strong language. And my point to you tonight is not that they should have viewed Lee as a god, but that they did. And people are now denying that. 4 months after the Chancellorsville episode, James Longstreet, the burr under Lee's saddle, although Lee never acknowledged it, achieved the independent command he had so long yearned for, went out to Chickamauga, which many of you have visited. And then at Knoxville, he wound up discovering that his yearning to be independent was fit under that old saying, be careful what you wish for. He ran into a situation where things didn't go the way he wanted. He finally had to launch a feckless attack in which two veteran divisions were butchered by about 120 Federals in a strong fort, Fort Sanders, in the middle of Knoxville. And the commanding general, who whipped him so thoroughly there, was the notoriously inept Ambrose Burnside. He was delighted to get back under what had once seemed Lee's onerous rule, and would again when the war was over and Lee was dead and he could take to casting stones. But this setup, this absence of one-third of Lee's army out to Chickamauga, East Tennessee, back through East Tennessee and Abingdon, Virginia, in the last week of April of 1864, that corps, which had been away from Lee now for 9 months, came back and was rejoined to the army. Actually, Lee came out to see them at the little crossroads of Mechanicsville. This isn't the famous Mechanicsville where there was a battle in June of 62 that some of you have been to with me. This is the old crossroads and church in the Green Springs district in Louisa County. Mechanicsville Baptist Church is still there, and that's where they were camped. They had a review. The troops lined up, the cavalry paraded, the flags were waved, the bands played. General Lee rode out to reunite with his old First Corps. And the accounts of this are almost stunning in the emotion that they convey about getting back together with General Lee. Just give you a couple of them. Here's Abram Hayne Young, a South Carolina infantryman. He was not particularly effective orthographically. He couldn't spell, wasn't all that literate, but he wrote to his sister the next morning. He said, "Yesterday we had a grand review by the greatest of generals, General Lee. Some of us went to shake hands with him, and some said they had shook hands with the greatest man in the world." And artillerist Alexander, cited above as an exemplar of the good witness option, suffered from no tendency whatever toward romanticism. He was a successful soldier and then businessman, railroad owner after the war, was actually much pilloried in the South when his military memoirs of a Confederate appeared for being too unkind to General Lee. There's really nothing wrong with him, he just wasn't absolutely adulatory. So he is not a sycophant by the damnedest of margins, and listen to the emotion in describing seeing Lee again after 9 months, reuniting with him. "The general reins up his horse and bears his good gray head and looks at us, and we shout and cry and wave our flags. Sudden as a wind, a wave of sentiment, such as can only come to large crowds in full sympathy, seemed to sweep over the field. Each man seemed to feel the bond which held us all to Lee. There was no speaking, but the effect was that of a military sacrament." Thus from the hard-nosed Porter Alexander. And exactly 7 days later, those young men who had cheered themselves hoarse at the Mechanicsville Review pounded down the Orange Plank Road from west to east in the wilderness, arriving at the climax of the greatest crisis that Lee and his army had yet faced near the Widow Tap Field, and many of you have been there too, seeing the famous Lee to the rear. And they redeemed the moment. The military sacrament, as Alexander described it, paid dividends far beyond any consideration of tactics or operations or strategy or logistics or anything else. In the wilderness and on other famous fields all up and down the mid-Atlantic littoral for the next year. Sergeant Abram Young, who I quoted to you, the fellow who wasn't that good a speller, he went into that breach with Kershaw's South Carolina Brigade, among the first to arrive, the 3rd Brigade to arrive there at the Tap Field, and a bullet in his lung laid him low, and he died that evening, 6 days after the enthusiastic letter to his sister, and 30 days before his 24th birthday. So let Sergeant Abram Young serve for you tonight for at least a moment as the indicative of the 650,000 or so experiences like him. Lee's perceived persona also worked its way on officers in close quarters with him, with only two exceptions out of the approaching 200 general officers who had relations with Lee at one time or another during the war. Only two of them actively disliked him, Roswell Ripley and James Longstreet. They stand in a very small minority. Although the general's modern detractors tend to consider Lee's facade artificial, even dishonest, contemporaries just absolutely could not see that. Samuel M. Bemis, a surgeon who treated Lee in the spring of 63 when the regular surgeon Lafayette Guild was on leave in Alabama, wrote home to his wife about having examined Lee twice and talked to him. And he waxed enthusiastic about Lee in that language written a few hours after he saw him the two times. It's about as emphatic as any post-war manipulator could have invented from whole cloth. "He is so noble a specimen of men that even if he were not so distinguished, you would be attracted by his appearance and manner. I know you would all love him." He's writing to his wife and his two children back home. "You would all love him if you saw him, with a deep, quiet admiration, which would find expression in a desire to imitate his actions and arrive at his excellencies." That's a pretty nice, concise description of how to show people how to behave. "You would want to act like him. On every visit, my admiration for him increases." Bemis, by the way, puts the quietus to the popular notion in a recent movie that Lee was sick at Gettysburg. This he's writing about having examined him just before they went north. Well, quoting Sergeant Bemis, Sergeant Young, Major York, artillerist Alexander, doesn't really prove anything out of an army of 65,000. They are representative, however, I can assure you, of an absolutely roaring boar tide of precisely that kind of sentiment, which is unmistakable, which is pervasive, which is everywhere. The only way anyone could miss the obvious evidence of Lee's towering wartime popularity in the South is to be entirely ignorant of the original sources. But I would suggest that people who say that kind of thing actually do you a service, at least in my rather strongly held view. Their position makes an irrefragable guide to the rest of it. If they believe that, they're probably not worth paying any attention to on anything else. Here's an interesting quote from as Yankee a Yankee as you could get, I suspect. I'll give you his pedigree. This is about how Lee's image in the North escalated from 1862 to 64 very dramatically as well. They didn't love him, obviously. They wished he would go away. He was thwarting them most decidedly. But this is a column from the New York Times written by its editor, one Henry J. Raymond. I'm sure Billy knows him. Billy's a Lincoln scholar. Raymond was a confidant of Lincoln's in the very closest circle. He was at this writing the chairman of the Republican Party, for goodness sakes. He was the editor of the New York Times, which has only become even-handed in more recent years. In those days, it was pretty polemical. He can hardly be accused, Henry J. Raymond, of being a conspirator, an early conspirator in the lost cause business, can he? And he says in one paragraph almost all the things the historians said about the Confederacy and they're now denigrated for, that they were outnumbered, they were overwhelmed. Hey, listen to Henry Raymond, Lincoln's bosom companion. The rebels have exhibited a most wonderful energy and skill in carrying on their struggle. No people on the face of this earth ever made so hard a fight with such limited means. All candid men, whatever their hatred of the rebellion, are free to admit that the final triumph of our national armies will be due only to superiority in numbers. Someone suggested that that was the case on the average American campus. They would be executed within hours without trial. And here is Henry Raymond saying that. An interesting manifestation, I think, of anti-Lee sentiment amongst modern revisionists and revisionism and revisionist writing is the notion that his deeply religious nature revealed personality and psychological disorders. You can imagine a modernist saying this sort of thing. Lee's devout faith, which he expressed constantly in public, in letters, both private and public, they pleased auditors in the 1860s. They thought that made him a better man and beyond. But in the 1970s and down to the present, that faith has been a linchpin for his detractors. The general's notions of his worthlessness without God's support, without God helping him, without God's guidance, his own worthlessness are entirely typical of early Victorian writing of anyone who was religious, but they serve as a text for modern detractors to depict Lee as insecure and even as a manic depressive because he thought he was worthless without supernatural help. Although I admit to you just for this purpose that I'm pretty much immune myself to the siren song of Solomon or whoever, and I don't even know where the road to Damascus is, I am perfectly content to respect Lee and even admire him for that sort of thing. I think the notion that it's a detriment to his character is pretty ludicrous. I really do. In all matters grown antique, we all ought to avoid the current climate, which is to view everything through the lens of today. We should avoid translating the current climate about everything, large, small, and intermediate, to the past, and of exploiting our knowledge to that ultimate end. We do not all honor that fundamental requirement. Those of you who've been on battlefields with me have heard me give a quote from an excellent British historian. I'll read it to you here about the whole thing. I always feel this way when we go on a battlefield, and we tend to view it as a war game, and oh, why didn't he do this, and why didn't he do this? Hindsight really is impeccable, but it's also illegitimate. Well, the astoundingly good British historian C.V. Wedgwood, has never written anything that doesn't delight me. Some of you will have seen her work. CV actually stands for, I think, for Cecilia Veronica, so she's got to be a British woman with that name. Wedgwood has written a nice, crisp summary of this need to avoid presentism, as it's sometimes called. History is lived forwards, but it is written in retrospect. We know the end before we even consider the beginning. And we could never wholly recapture what it was to know the beginning only. Well, you really ought to try to do that when you read about things past, when you visit sites from the past, but the concept is not entirely comfortable in the circles of which I'm complaining. Novelist Philip Roth has written, kind of delighting me, I think it's deftly said, that one of Americans' most fervently embraced communal passions is indulging in an ecstasy of sanctimony about their self-defined advancements over others, considering the moral failings, real or imagined, of others, past and present. I'm reminded of the antinomian heresy, but I ought not to talk about that in front of a theology professor on the front row here. In reverse application, Confederates as secular infidels, they haven't been saved by grace and can behave any way they darn well please. On the contrary, they cannot redeem themselves from being wrong, no matter what they say or what they do. Their testimony about Lee, about anything, does not have standing. And another personal anecdote here for you, which I think is on point. A bright youngster from Ohio was obsessed with the Civil War since he was a tiny fellow. His grandparents brought him on a tour I led of Gettysburg when he cannot have been more than 7 or 8. He came to them through his teens on his own. He's a licensed tour guide at Gettysburg himself now. He was from Ohio. He was interested in Ohio troops. He was not besmirched by any hint of Confederate propinquity by birth, origin, blood, locale, interest, or anything else. But he was attending an Ohio prep school. He was a very smart kid, and he got a scholarship to a place like this. Not nearly as nice, I'm sure. Not remotely as well run. Not nearly as distinguished looking a headmaster. It couldn't be possible. But in Ohio, he had done very well. He was going to graduate with honors, and he had to do a paper for the honors program, as so often is the case. And he chose history. He chose the Civil War. He chose the Battle of Fredericksburg, because he'd been there many times with me, among others. And he mentioned in this paper the peculiar phenomenon, some of you will have heard of it, the night after the battle, not the night of the 13th, the night of the day after the battle, the 14th of December, there was a gaudy aurora borealis on the northern skyline. And a good many of the Southerners had never seen such a thing or even heard of it. And they marveled at it, and some of them, as they wrote home or wrote in their diaries, they suggested that this must be some sort of divine applause for the great Confederate victory at Fredericksburg. Well, the young boy mentioned this in his letter, because the Southerners, some of them were deeply religious, some of them were superstitious, some of them were just fey or easily impressed, and they theorized about that. The boy didn't say that this was the case, he just mentioned it. Well, he was marked down by his teacher. He had marked it down because the lad was accepting the notion forwarded by a Confederate. He had cited one Confederate account. Not that the event had special meaning, but that the Confederate had said it happened. A fundamental historical premise in some circles, well worth learning and remembering, this fellow was going to help the boy out, is that Southerners made things up and cannot be trusted. So he marked him down, and the boy sent me an email, and I sent him back several accounts by people from Rhode Island and other such places, which presumably could be relied upon. The boy now is in graduate school in Ohio, going for his PhD, but I'm sure the teacher at Lovett North is still saving boys from the infidelity of believing what Southerners say. I'm reminded of Henry Adams, who famously said, "The Southerner has no mind." Some of you probably have seen that. And he went on, he was particularly outraged by William Henry Fitzhugh Lee, known as Rooney Lee, R.E.'s son, the big strapping fellow, too big to be a man, too small to be a horse, they said of him. He went to Harvard for one same year with Henry Adams, and Adams particularly hated Rooney Lee. And that prompted him to say, "The Southerner has no mind." Well, someone has taken the trouble to look up the records of those two fellows in their first year at Harvard, and Rooney Lee did have really bad grades, but Henry Adams's were worse, which kind of delighted me when I heard it. George Washington, who impresses me steadily indeed, nearly as steadily as he impressed his granddaughter's husband, R.E. Lee, wrote what I think is a gorgeously crafted paragraph about the wide chasms that develop between human reactions to the same evidence. This is something you ought to apply to all of your engagements in life. My friend Hap Morris believes some of the most incredible political nonsense imaginable, and he and I are responding to the same things. He got through Lovett School, so I guess he's at least got something for him. But here's George Washington talking about that. I think this is a beautiful piece of work from that brilliant fellow. Thomas Jefferson had concluded that George Washington, who was apostatizing from the true revolution, according to Thomas Jefferson, could not be doing so in a straightforward and ingenuous fashion. Jefferson kind of concluded maybe he was getting a little bit senile, or perhaps he'd been bamboozled by some clever and sinister advisors. And when Washington heard of this, he framed a reply that covers this business about receiving the evidence and analyzing it and winding up different. I think it's beautifully written. Shall I arrogantly pronounce that whosoever differs from me must discern the subject through a distorting medium or be influenced by some nefarious scheme? The mind is so formed in different persons as to contemplate the same objects in different points of view. Hence originates the difference on questions of the greatest importance, human and divine. Well, I think that's a lovely paragraph, and it's opposite to what we're talking about here. So it applies to subjective viewpoints on records and achievements and everything else that we do. What you think of Lee or Jackson or Grant or Benjamin Beast Butler or anyone else you want to list. Humans of powerful minds, or even just good minds, and contemplative means wind up differing on things like this. Was Lee's performance at Chancellorsville foolishness redeemed by luck, or was one of the greatest campaigns in history? Up to you to decide. Was East Cemetery Hill in the gloaming on July 1, that fading light, was it within reach, or was it an impossible phantasm? Those subjective calls almost everything in our life, which is so full of subjectivity, everything we perceive and conclude in our quotidian existence day to day, produces variable reactions. I grew up in the mountains near Yosemite, and I think Yosemite is the most beautiful place in the world. How could I ever prove that? It can't be done. I once took a visitor, a person of my acquaintance who'd never been there before, and there at the stunning grandeur of Glacier Point, she didn't want to get out of the car. She didn't think it was worth going to look. Well, that seems to me to be, I don't know what it is, but we do differ in our reaction to things, do we not? In an entirely objective matter, not at all subjective, of weighing Lee's wartime popularity, deserved or not, I would submit that you've got to apply Hanlon's razor to it. It's really the only multiple choice available for denying that patent truth. Malice, ignorance, sloth, or all of them in a very generous admixture. Looking beyond our own time, I'm delighted to contemplate the survivor of literally millions of words written by Lee himself, written by his contemporaries, his family, his friends, his subordinates, his superiors, those around him. There's no need for any of you, anyone anywhere, now or later, to accept my view of this, although it probably would be a good idea, I hasten to stipulate that. But you don't have to accept it or reject it, nor that of his detractors. You can decide for yourself. It's eminently easy. There's really no difficulty at all. Just take a look for yourself. And with that in mind, I have no doubt, I really don't, that there will always be a great many young people growing up hither and yon, maybe in the foothills of the Sierra Nevada, as I did many decades ago, without any hint of precedential Southern propinquity or interest at all, who will read and will muse and will marvel and will come away attached and eager to learn more.
I give my talk about Longstreet, people are usually ready to bring out the vegetables and eat them, but this is what I'm saying.
Can you briefly talk about Shara's characterization of Lee in Killing Angels? I know it's very popular and very contemporary. I just want to hear your thoughts.
He asks for my thoughts about Shara's representation of Lee in Killer Angels.
I have a letter that Shara wrote in which he expressed amused but gratified, because he was getting royalties on it, amusement at how his book was becoming the most read book about Gettysburg, how it was reading at the U.S. Army War College, and he said what is obvious to anyone who's ever read it. He said, essentially, I use two books. I use Chamberlain and I use Longstreet. And it's a novel. It's fiction. And it seems to me to be patent nonsense. When I read it, I haven't read it for quite a while, I loved every word of it about the Federals, because I don't know enough about them to know different. And he limes them, he sketches them so beautifully. It's a very well done piece of work, Killer Angels, won the Pulitzer Prize. Every time he starts talking about Confederates, based on no research at all, it's just silly to me. Not the big questions, those are for sure too, but he kind of liked Louis Armstead, killed at the forefront of Pickett's Charge. And he painted a fictional picture of him and made him an attractive fellow and said he was a ladies' man and that his nickname was Low, short for Lothario, because he was such a handsome devil, like the Pope boys when they were at Lovett School many years ago. Low Armistead. Well, I know a lot about Armistead. I've always been interested in him. I've seen every scrap at the National Archives about him, and he was about as un-Lothario, to coin a neolocution, as anyone ever was. He had two children. He had a wife who went to the frontier with him. She died in a period of about 12 hours after cholera struck her there at Fort Riley on the frontier. He raised the kids by himself, brought them back, took care of them. There's not a hint of that anywhere. Well, that's all right. It's a novel. But don't tell me that it's history about Low Armistead. And then when he gets to the other things, it's all, he accepts Longstreet at face value, and Longstreet is, in my view, very nearly useless. Those of you who have not read my chapter about Longstreet at Gettysburg, you should. Everybody should have that, but you really should. And don't get the paperback, because the royalties are only a third as much. Get the hardback, my God. Whether you believe Longstreet or not, he certainly needs some balance. I just spent the last week having been hired by a very successful popular historian, an Englishman named Michael Korda. Some of you will have read him, K-O-R-D-A. He wrote the great book about the Battle of Britain, the Wings of Eagles or something like that. Biographies of Lawrence of Arabia and Montgomery and Eisenhower and 40 or 50 books, and he's very advanced in years. He decided he was going to write about Lee, and he sent me the manuscript to read. And the Gettysburg chapter is just Shara Redux. It's son of the Gettysburg movie. And I sent him a fairly pointed essay about it. And he wrote back and he said, oh my goodness, I didn't know all of that. And he's going to go back to work on it. But the impact of that will last forever. And it doesn't really matter. If you want to swallow it, all of us swallow nonsense every day. My wife told me I was handsome the other day, and I almost believed her. That's not quite as much of a stretch as believing Shara. But Shara has been very good for the Civil War industry. Is the Civil War an industry? Well, it is for saving the battlefields, which has been my main avocation for many, many decades. Anything that heightens interest in the war, keeps people interested in the battlefields, is good for us. But I would not believe it. And he also accepts the notion that Lee was just so sick at Gettysburg. Something was going to happen. The scouts would bring him the news, and he'd have to hold on to the fence post because he felt so weak. And he had to turn to Longstreet for help. Well, on the question of Longstreet, I'll quote you Dick Taylor, which is the last, I quote him as the last sentence in my chapter on Longstreet at Gettysburg. Dick Taylor's a wonderful witness. He was about as well-placed as anyone could be. He was a lieutenant general in the Confederate Army. He knew all these people. His father had been president of the United States. His brother-in-law was president of the Confederate States, so he had access. He was connected. And he was writing his great memoir, Destruction and Reconstruction. Just as the Gettysburg controversy was boiling up. And he said at one point in a public article, he said the notion that anything that required intellect or thought could be clear to Longstreet and confused to Lee is startling to anyone who knew the two men. Longstreet graduated next to last at the military academy. Custer was last, and look how well that didn't work out so well either. In ethics, which proved to be a real problem, in my view, for Longstreet later in life. In ethics at West Point, he was last even behind the notoriously unethical Earl Van Dorn, who wound up being shot by a cuckold husband during the Civil War, if you don't know about Earl Van Dorn. Longstreet's, doesn't mean he's wrong, but his mental capacity compared to Lee's was somewhat different. Well, read it. Buy it in hardback and read it. Yes, sir.
What did Lee most want to be remembered for personally?
I don't know that I can answer that. But he was stunningly modest. He was the most pragmatic, goals-oriented major officer I've ever looked at in American military history. He wanted results. People wonder whether he knew what Longstreet felt about him during the war, and I'm not sure. Longstreet, on October 5, 1862, wrote a letter to Joe Johnston, who'd been his collaborator in A Gargantuan Lie about the Battle of Seven Pines and was out of the Army. He said, come back to the Army, come back. The troops will love you more than they could ever love anyone else. If he believed that, he was lying, and if he didn't, he was stunningly unaware. And by spring, we will get you back in command of the Army. We'll get rid of Lee. Did Lee know that? I don't know. If he did, it wouldn't have mattered at all. He was looking for results. He was pragmatic. One of the famous quotes that tells you a lot about Lee is in the second week of May of 1864 outside Fredericksburg at Spotsylvania. A.P. Hill came to him, and a Georgian named A.R. Wright, known as Rands Wright, who was a big wheel in politics down here after the war, was a longtime brigadier. He'd never been promoted. I don't know that he did particularly badly, but A.P. Hill was outraged over what he'd done over next to the Anderson House. He said, we've got to get rid of him. We've got to get rid of him. And Lee calmly said three things to him, according to a staff officer who was curiously listening in. He said, we need to think about this for a while. What would you say to the people of Georgia? And who would you put in his place? All of which are looking toward the bigger picture. You know, famously after the war, that Lee was not entirely reconstructed. That's another thing. Lee is viewed as being false in his attitude toward the federal government because he really was not reconstructed. Duh, as my son used to say 30 years ago. But he was doing his level best to make the best of a bad situation. You've probably heard the little anecdote, which is entirely typical of Lee. I don't know if he'd want to be remembered for that, but it reveals him. Whenever infrequently he agreed to go to anything that had to do with reunions or public events or celebrations or anything. But when a couple of times he got euchred into them, he carefully, purposely walked out of step with the people around him so it didn't look like it was some sort of a military parade. Trying to make the best of a bad situation. I think Lee was a great man, quite aside from the military things. I don't doubt that there were men just as good as him who were gentlemen farmers in Brunswick County or somewhere in Virginia at the same time. They just never got the stage and the spotlight to illuminate that. Yes, sir, way back there.
Thank you for your talk this evening and this morning as well. I wonder if you might comment on the possibility that the adulation of Lee and Jackson and the dimming of other Confederate generals, I'm thinking of Johnston and Hood here in local province,
yeah,
might have prevented an analysis of the loss of the war for the Confederacy through the decades of the 19th century.
Well, I suppose... He's at the back, you all probably could hear him. He wonders whether the adulation for Lee and Jackson and their larger-than-life images might have dimmed understanding of what Joe Johnston and the rest did around Atlanta. I have a stunningly low opinion of Joe Johnston. In the Steve Davis is here, and I think he's named all of his kids Joe Johnston with different middle initials, actually. But, where are you, Steve? I've written a chapter about him in the book about the eight full generals in the Confederacy, and I focused on his attitude. I pay a lot of attention to attitude. Longstreet was very capable. If he hadn't been, his attitude wouldn't leave the Army in the pinch that it was. Joe Johnston spent the whole war whining and moaning and puling about rank. Not just rank, but rank by where he was listed on the page of the people who were promoted the same day. He had spent his whole pre-war career doing that. And all of his promotions in the old Army were built on a castle of sand. His first one came when, after just a couple of years out of West Point, he resigned in a snit in the middle of the Seminole War because somebody else had been promoted and he hadn't been yet. So he resigned and went to work as a private topographic engineer. He drew the first map of the Dade Massacre, if some of you have heard of that, as a private topographic engineer. Well, the Seminoles set upon a surveying party and he did a fabulous job, personal bravery, acting as the rear guard while they got back to the boats. And somebody on the spur of the moment breveted him for doing this. Well, you can't brevet a civilian by definition. You can't give the Medal of Honor to a civilian. If he wins the Cold War and ends the national debt, the Medal of Honor is for people who are commissioned and enlisted in the arms, and the same was for brevets then. So that was bogus. It, well, It's very complicated. I think he was small-minded and mean-spirited and selfish, and I don't like that. I like Dick Yule. Yule was a failure. He's one of the two Corps commanders promoted in the Vice Jackson in the May of 1863, and he never succeeded, and he wound up a failure. He wound up being sent to Coventry, the defenses of Richmond, the local defense troops. But I still admire him. He was doing his level damnedest. It wasn't good enough. I don't suppose he would have thought it was good enough if you really could ask him, but he was doing his level damnedest. People like Longstreet and Joe Johnston, who couldn't see beyond the end of their noses, the absolute antithesis of what I just talked about, Lee's pragmatism, they annoy me. And Joe Johnston is one. That's not really what you asked, but I talked about it anyway. Someone else? Yes, sir?
What impact on Lee's legacy does his time in Lexington have?
His legacy from his time in Lexington, did you say? Well, I was introduced to someone a bit ago who's a graduate of Washington and Lee. There may be more than one of you here. He devoted himself to education. He was a absolute genius. Well, not a genius. He was the perfect match for raising funds. I read to you a few of the things about how much Northerners admired him. And Northern men with money who had some human sensibilities about rehabilitating the South rather than turning it into a series of vassal states made to vote the right way. A good many industrialists in the North, leading among them, Peabody did a good bit of this. The fellow with the museum in Washington, what's his name? A lot of these people sent money. Here was a unexcelled example of an attitude of getting the sides back together, of healing the wounds was Lee. And Washington and Lee became what it was today with money that was poured in there because Lee was there to accept it. In those days, you didn't have to drive a BMW or an Audi to be admitted to the school. That came later. But Lee did a great deal of good. The number of students who went to W&L during his almost five-year tenure there was not huge, but it became kind of the lodestar for education in the South and turning the South around. And it's a tremendous, tremendous thing. The one thing he didn't do there, although if he had, it wouldn't matter. I'd want a first edition desperately. He didn't write anything about the war. He kept saying he was going to. But if he had, it would have been almost completely useless, I am sure, because it would have been careful and dignified and not critical of anyone and not heaping too much praise on anyone. Lee, in his reports, almost amusingly, always used third person, as he's supposed to, never wrote in the first person, never used passive voice, which is a way of avoiding writing in the first person, except when he was talking about himself. So when once in a while you will see something in a Lee report that says, "It was decided," that means I did it, but I'm not going to say I did it. He was very, very circumspect about all that sort of thing. So the book that he was planning to write, that he sent out printed questionnaires to key subordinates, asked for their reports of the last 6 months of the war, which had either not been submitted or had been lost and burned in the Richmond fire on April 2nd and 3rd. I wish he'd written that, but on the other hand, after due thought, it probably wouldn't have been worth much. Been a hell of an artifact, though, wouldn't it? Yes, sir.
What are your thoughts of Nathan Bedford Farr, and what was his relationship with
Lee? What do I think about Nathan Bedford Forrest and what was his relationship with Lee? Well, as those of you who've been around the battlefields with me know, I've got tunnel vision. There's a saying about experts, you know, they know more and more about less and less till they know everything about nothing. Well, I'm just about there. And if it happened west of the Shenandoah Valley, and it used to be south of Petersburg, I didn't care. Now, my son has been historian for the Richmond battlefields for 20 years, and we have, like a couple of conquering czars, divided Virginia between us. So now I don't care about anything south of Long Run, just north of the North Anna River. That's Bobby's. So I know a good bit about what happened there. I don't know much about Nathan Bedford Forrest. People always ask about him. He had no relationship with Lee, had no interaction with Lee. Lee became commander-in-chief of the armies over Jeff Davis's virulent opposition on the last day of February in 65. So how many hours did that leave him? But Forrest has a far larger reputation than he deserves in this regard. I don't know enough about him to be at all critical or positive, but he was so colorful and so popular and so eccentric, Americans love eccentrics, that he got all of this profile, and the stage upon which he performed was never larger than 6,000 or 7,000 men, and usually was 3,000 or 4,000. And he apparently did wonderful things with them, but that's like the question of apples and oranges, or apples and kiwi fruit seeds, to talk about a corps commander who commanded 35,000 men for many years. It's a whole different universe. So I don't know, but I think people who talk about why didn't Bedford Forrest get more of this and more of that, well, would have been a good idea, obviously, if Joe Johnston or Braxton Bragg had turned him loose to raise hell in some rear areas. I can say that with some confidence. But he's just not in the discussion till you get down to one of Stuart's division commanders. Bedford Forrest never commanded as many cavalry as Jeb Stuart did in this theater for balance. There's a comparison. I can't make it. Stuart, Forrest, somebody might do that. I'm not the one. Yes, sir, front row.
What was the relationship between John Mosby and Robert E. Lee?
That's very much sort of a cousin to the other one. He says, what was the relationship between John Mosby and R.E. Lee? Mosby had tremendous press. He was dashing and he was daring, and they jumped on their horses and they rode all over Northern Virginia. And he never commanded more than about 800 men, though. And the question of whether the flea on the flanks aspect, the distraction of the Federals, the necessity to put guards on the trains going through Manassas Gap, whether that sucked enough strength away from the Federals elsewhere in Virginia to be a good thing or not. There's some evidence that Lee thought it was more form than substance there. He wasn't sure that the partisan ranger notion was a good one. But then they made that TV series. Some of you are too young to remember that. And the book about the gray ghosts. And people, there's a whole lot of people who study the Civil War who love cavalry. And you gotta wonder what it is. I mean, there's the heavy breathing and the sweaty bodies, and then there's the horses too and all the rest. And people really like cavalry more than they do infantry. Some people do. And a lot of you are probably horse people down in this country, so maybe that's part of the deal. But Mosby's not in Lee's ambit at all. He's really not. Jim Phillips wants to ask me if University of Georgia football team's ever going to get good again. Is that the question, Jim? If they could play Appalachian State again this week.
I had an easier question than that. Yeah. What about the speculation that if Albert Sidney Johnston had been killed at Shiloh because of his relationship with Jeff Davis, he might have gotten Joe Johnston's job?
Yeah. That's one of the most enchanting and enticing and alluring of the what-ifs that we all enjoy doing. And you ought not spend your life running up and down parallel universes, but it's really irresistible sometimes. Jim has said, what about the business if Albert Sidney Johnston hadn't bled to death at Shiloh in April of 62? How would that have changed things? He was very close to Jeff Davis. Many of you probably know Jefferson Davis viewed Albert Sidney Johnston as almost an idol when they were at West Point together. Davis was a feckless youth and a freshman and never was all that good on interpersonal relationships. And Albert Sidney Johnston, who was a very handsome fellow, sort of a 19th century Bob Glenn, I guess you could say. Albert Sidney had the big mustache. The mustache always adds to men's attraction from what I can understand. And he was a dashing fellow. He was from Texas. He had been Lee's superior, 2nd Cavalry on the frontier. And he was a magnificent fellow in any number of ways. And it's enchanting to think about what he could have done if he lived, especially because Jeff Davis worshipped him, and Jeff Davis was an incubus at the throat of all things Confederate military. Jefferson Davis was a failure as a president. It's hard to imagine any major figure in American history more poorly conceived to head a revolutionary experience than the ultra-straight Jeff Davis. You probably know if he was walking down the street in Richmond and he saw a member of the Congress coming toward him, he would carefully go in a building across the street so he didn't have to speak to them privately because he considered that improper, showing special preference to someone. That's not the way you run an experimental revolutionary experience. Lee, one of Lee's great contributions, I didn't even mention it tonight, is he ran Jeff Davis like a marionette in a puppet show. He did a great job of it. Some of his detractors say, hey, you all say Lee is so honorable. Look at the way he scammed Jeff Davis. Well, you're darn right he did, and good for him. Albert Sidney Johnston could have done that even better. Now, the question is, was Albert Sidney Johnston the military leader that he appears to be? Well, we don't know that. People say, what if John F. Reynolds hadn't been killed at Gettysburg? Would he have been the great savior of the Union? We don't know. He didn't have an opportunity. He was killed before he had a chance, both of those guys and many another. And I don't know. It's interesting to speculate. But it's just really not knowable, I'm afraid. Jefferson Davis had such a compartmentalized mind. He was plenty brilliant, but so wooden, so compartmentalized, that he was a burr in the cog of everything that happened. He insisted on having departments divided up geographically on the ground. And Lee never commanded until a few days before the end of the war more than the Department of Northern Virginia. And when he fell back in due rest in the spring of 1864, when R.E. Lee fell back and was approaching the James River, Beauregard had about 30,000 men just across the river. Lee could not tell Beauregard to do. He had to approach him as though he were the Grand Duchy of Luxembourg approaching the Crown Prince of Monaco. What can we work out? How can you help me? Well, Beauregard was a visionary in the most pejorative sense of that word. And he always had ideas that you give me your men and then we'll go up here and we'll get on some boats and we'll be in Washington just a few days from now. And everyone knew that. So Davis was just so compartmentalized. But what makes does pre-war experience make you a great general? Does it help? I'll tell you one thing that American history shows us, and I don't think all that many people talk about it, is that a generation produces only a tiny handful of men who are capable of leading huge armies across swaths of ground to good advantage. It's not just brains, it's not just training, there's something magic in it. And when Jackson went down, they never found anybody close to replace him. I always think of John Charles Fremont in connection with this. Fremont was just a heck of a man. You know some of the things he did. They called him the Pathfinder because he was. He went across the Great Divide when it was completely wild country. He went over the Sierra Nevada, crossing at the same pass in the middle of the winter, where a few years later the Donner Party ran into its famous commissary quandary that you've all heard about. He went right over that pass. He helped suppress the Mexican government, make California a state. I guess that's a good thing. Used to be, anyway. He did all these things. He was a real man, and he came to the Civil War. The great event that was going on was given a division, and he could not command 8,000 men in the Shenandoah Valley. It was like he was chasing his tail. So it's not bravery, it's not brains, it's not training. You need all of those things, but you need something else. And there weren't that many of them. Did Albert Sidney Johnston have it? We have no idea. But it's awfully interesting to think about what he brought to the table, as Jim has said. Yes, sir. Yeah.
Episode. That was not the only time that at the end of the war similar situations came up. What's your opinion on the speculation that Lee saw the end and he didn't want to survive and he was kind of looking to go out in a blaze of glory or be a martyr?
The business about the lead of the rear, which is that dramatically famous episode, there were actually four of them in 6 days, but the famous was on the 6th of May at the Widow Tap Field, where a bunch of you have stood with me at various times in the wilderness. This was not really that close to the end of the war. It was morning of May the 6th of 64, so the war had 11 months and 3 days until Appomattox to go. I think unquestionably, I'm not much for psychobabble, but it's hard to avoid thinking about the fact that for the first time since he took command of the army, there in the wilderness, Lee was on the verge of disaster. He'd had a hard time at Sharpsburg and other times, but it was always a way to knit it together. Things were falling apart in the wilderness. And when the Texas Brigade came forward and he took off his hat and waved and wanted to go in with them, and they turned their backs and said, General Lee, go back. We won't go forward unless you go back. And he said to one of the officers, can I not die for my country too? Which is oft quoted. He was trying to save the army in the breach. He did similar things two of the other three on a much smaller scale, and the third one really not as much, in 6 days, never did it again. So I would suggest to you, if you're looking for some sort of psychological construct to make sense of all that, he probably was trying to come to terms with the fact that the army was out of men. Grant had limitless men. Quickly became apparent he was willing to kill all of them if necessary and went about doing it pretty much. Joan Wall will tell you that's not true in a few months when you see her here. And was just doing what it took to knit the army back together. But after the 6 days, after the 12th of May, there in the heart of the Bloody Angle, he never did it again to the end of the war when things really did fall apart. So there's a guess for you. I wouldn't want to be dogmatic about it. I never am. You've probably noticed by now. Someone else was right nearby. There you are. Yes, sir.
Just to be curious about your thoughts on Sharpsburg, the significance of that. Should Lee have done more of that? Should the Confederacy have done more of that? Just your thoughts on the overall Battle of Sharpsburg.
Should have done more of going across the river? Should have done more like Sharpsburg for what?
As far as being more of an aggression, more moving into the
Yeah. Front
rather than just trying to be so defensive.
Yeah.
And also his relationship with A.P. Hill in that battle.
And the relationship with Hill, yeah. Should Lee have gone across the Potomac more than he did? Lee's greatest strength, in my view, was his ability to maneuver. It didn't matter if he had been a tactical or even an operational genius, which we have no way of knowing because he never did that. He was a laissez-faire general, if you will. He put his corps commanders in position very often consummately well, but then it was up to them to run the war. And with Jackson, that worked absolutely perfectly. Longstreet, not so much. Ewell, not at all, but that was his system. So he put them in position, and maneuvering got better the farther north you went. That's why he went into Pennsylvania, to take the army out of Virginia. People who call that an invasion, I suppose it's a matter of semantics, but they really ought not to call Lee's move into Pennsylvania an invasion by any standard military usage. He didn't want Pennsylvania. He didn't want all those Percherons and Clydesdales and Barnes. He wanted to get the war out of Virginia. He wanted to put the onus on the enemy. He wanted to give himself a stage upon which to maneuver, which he did incomparably well. He didn't want to add Pennsylvania to the Confederacy. And there really were no other opportunities to do that I can see. You said something about his relationship with A.P. Hill. Lee got on just fine with A.P. Hill. Jackson is the one who had the troubles with A.P. Hill, serious troubles. Hill was a prickly fellow. In fact, he once described himself in a letter to Jeb Stuart complaining about Jackson. He says, I'm as prickly as a porcupine. And it's hard to argue with him. He was a sensitive, proud fellow. Pretty good officer, very good division commander. Seems to be an archetype for the Peter Principle as corps commander. But he was so steadily ill with something still somewhat mysterious that he did not accomplish much as a corps commander. People used to say it was psychosomatic because he always went into decline when the stress was high. That may be so. There's a theorem about it having been prostatitis now, but that's based on a very, very weak set of bamboo caissons that don't get you across the river, I don't think. But Lee got on just fine with him. He recognized Hill as a strong right arm at the division level. I'm sure he was disappointed with him as a corps commander, but who else was there?
About one more question.
One more.
Why do you think that Lee developed as he did as a leader and a manager, given his father's history?
What I heard his father's history, I didn't get the rest.
I said, why do you think Lee developed as he did as a manager, but more importantly as a leader, given his father's history?
His father's history. Not all of you will know. Yes, did Lee develop in some wise in consequence of his father's history? His father was one of the more famous subordinate general officers of the American Revolution. I'm sure most of you know Henry Lee, known as Light Horse Harry Lee, a very skillful commander of partisans in the mold of Francis Marion, the Swamp Fox, and so on, and a patriot. His father, though, was something of a wastrel with money. And R.E. Lee grew up impoverished. If he hadn't, he wouldn't have gone to West Point. There's one for you. You talked about his father. His father hadn't left him impoverished. He never would have gone to West Point. You never would have heard of him. But as regards his father's legacy, Lee's family was, in addition to his father's difficulty, his father was all but killed by a Federalist mob in Baltimore in 1814. Family never saw him again. He went into refuge and died down here in the island off your coast of Georgia, as you probably know. Lee's own half-brother was called Black Horse Harry Lee because he got engaged in the sort of thing that happens to the mayor of San Diego all the time, and they didn't have good week-long counseling to turn him right around like happened with the mayor of San Diego. He got into serious trouble. It involved embezzlement as well as the other kind of misbehavior with a ward. He was Black Horse was a good name for him. And people have theorized, people who like to look for psychological origins, was Lee hoping to retrieve his father's name? Was he hoping to live down his half-brother's shame? Was he? I don't know, but I rather imagine he was trying to do his level best as God gave him the light to do it, and he did it pretty well.
Thank you, Bob.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.